makers of Chase and Sanborn Coffee, the superb blend you know is fresh, present the Chase and Sanborn Hour, and your host, Edward Arnold.
Good evening. This is Edward Arnold inviting you to join us on another Chase and Sanborn Hour with Nelson Eddy, Edgar Bergen, and Charlie McCarthy, Dorothy Lamour, Claude and Clarence Stroud, Robert Armbruster, and the Chase and Sanborn Orchestra, and our special guest, Ralph Bellamy. Tonight, Edgar Bergen has taken Charlie McCarthy to Chicago, where Charlie will be given an honorary degree by Dean Dennis of Northwestern University. And we're all going to hear Charlie as he accepts the degree.
You know, Ed, I can't understand that degree Charlie's getting. He told me it was Doctor of Arpeggio, Minestrone, and Luftpauser.
Sounds like a McCarthy misconstruction, Nelson.
Well, what's he going to do with it? Eat it? Sing it? Or wear it?
Well, Charlie told me he was going to be a Bachelor of Love.
A Bachelor of Love? Can you get a degree like that in a college?
Don't worry, Charlie will.
If you'll pardon the interruption, Dorothy, I'm sure that you're all wrong. Charlie made it very clear to me that he was to receive the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, the finest and highest honor a university can bestow.
Ah, you may be right, Clarence, but there's something peculiar about this. Wait till he gets back. We'll give him the third degree. But right now, Nelson Eddy gives us a rousing song of old England with words by Robert Browning. Marching along, Nelson Eddy.
Kentish Sir Bing stood for his king, bidding the crop-headed parliament win. And pressing a troop unable to stoop and see the rogue flourish an honest folk group. March them along, 50 score strong, gray-hearted gentlemen singing this song. March them along, 50 score strong, gray-hearted gentlemen singing this song. King calls him and such calls to the devil that drums and their treasonous calls. Cavaliers all lit from the cup and from the pacing abide. Take not up till you're marching along, 50 score strong. Great-hearted gentlemen singing the song, marching along, 50 score strong. Great-hearted gentlemen singing this song. Then God the King calls him in his mouth to the devil that tricks on such pestilent calls. Oh, by the right, you double your might, onward to Nottingham, fresh for the fight. March we along, 50 score strong, great-hearted gentlemen singing this song. March we along, 50 score strong, great-hearted gentlemen singing this song.
The deservingly popular composition of Haydn Wood, Brown Bird Singing, Nelson Eddy.
but the song of my heart could go a-winging, could go a-winging to you, to you. All through the night time my lonely heart is singing sweeter songs of love than the
Grand Nelson. Do you notice something funny around here today?
You mean something funny not around here today?
Yeah, we both mean the same thing. You know, it's so unnaturally restful with Charlie in Chicago.
Yeah, no heckling, no left-handed compliments.
Yeah, no one to kid me about my size. You know, it's so calm and peaceful.
How true. It's so nice and quiet.
Oh, it's so nice and quiet, isn't it, huh? Nobody can make any remarks about your size. What makes you think they can't? Hey, Arnold, you're so...
Now, Charlie, you're not going to start that again, are you?
All right.
People will think that you don't like Mr. Arnold.
Oh, that's not true. That's not true. I miss him. I really do.
Well, that's fine.
Yes.
I'm glad he'll hear that. Oh, he sure will. He sure will, yes. I guess that's what you meant.
That's nice and clumsy.
Yes.
I even wanted a picture of him before I went away.
Oh, you did?
Uh-huh.
Well, I'm sure Mr. Arnold would be glad to give you a photograph.
I think so, too.
Yes.
Yes, I'm sure he would. You think he'd send me a group picture of himself? Or a panorama view? See, I'm burning Arnold up and he can't even answer me back.
Yes, yes. It isn't fair to be talking about Mr. Arnold when he isn't here to defend himself.
I guess you're right, Bergen. I think I'll pick on you instead. Now, take your hair, for example.
All right, all right. Just a minute, young man. You're getting entirely too smart for your own good. And I'm going to make it my duty to straighten you out.
Oh, is that so? You know, Bergen, ever since they made you a Texas Ranger down at Fort Worth, you'll become very difficult to live with.
Well, I'm very proud of being made a Ranger.
Uh-huh.
And I regard it as a great compliment.
Yes, I guess they like me too, don't you think?
Well, don't be too sure of yourself.
Oh, no.
At the presentation ceremony, you showed very poor judgment in some of your remarks.
Well, what have I done now, Ranger? That's Tex Bergen. I'm in Dutch. I gotta humor him.
Yes.
What did I do down there?
Well, you know, when Colonel Garrison and the 12 Rangers marched out in dress uniform?
Yeah, well, they had guns on them, too, you know.
Yes, I know. Remember when they stood there in back of us?
Yeah, they surrounded us. They sort of sneaked up.
No. Well, they were paying us a great compliment, and what did you say?
All I said was, I'm innocent, so help me.
That's exactly what I mean.
How?
Do you realize what the Texas Rangers stand for?
Well, if they stand for you, I'm disappointed in them.
Never mind that.
How?
They spell death to the outlaws.
Yeah?
Yes. They're always on the lookout for lawbreakers, cattle rustlers, and bank robbers.
Yeah, well, they can't pin that on me. I got witnesses.
All right, all right. They've pinned nothing on you.
Well, that's good. I'm glad of that.
And when they presented me with those original six-shooters,
uh-huh,
I was thrilled.
You were scared.
No.
Tell me, Bergen, do you carry the revolver?
Yes, yes, I do.
You do?
Yes.
Oh, my. Ism a Texas Ranger, ism?
Yes, I'm a Texas Ranger. And I hope to live up to their fine standard of manhood.
Bergen, you don't really think America is counting on you for protection, do you?
Well, no, I don't. But I'm ready to help and make America a safer place in which to live.
Yeah?
Yes.
Well, then turn in your gun.
No. You know, Charlie, I was very proud when I had to say goodbye to them.
Yes,
and for the fine entertainment they gave and that reception.
Yes.
And, you know, saying goodbye was the saddest part of all.
Yes, it was. You know, I wanted to cry all the way to Chicago.
Well, I didn't notice you crying on the train.
Well, I was interrupted by a blonde girl.
Yes. You mean the one you met in the diner?
Yeah.
Was she pretty?
Pretty. She was exotic.
Yes.
Oh, such lips. Such complexion. Those eyelashes, oh, did you notice them?
Were they long?
Long, those eyelashes? They were so long, when she closed her eyes, they got in the mashed potatoes.
Well, how did you happen to strike up an acquaintance with her?
Well, I walked into the diner, and I couldn't see you, and that's the way it was.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was sitting right there.
You were?
Yes.
That's funny.
You couldn't see me?
No. Well, what I mean is, when I saw her, I couldn't see you.
No.
Which often happens.
But she was a stranger, Charlie. How did it happen that you started talking with her?
She has so much to learn. Well, it's possible, you know.
I presume so.
We started talking over the salad bowl.
I see.
I was mixing my own special salad dressing, you know. The McCarthy Creme de la Supreme, you know.
Sure.
Yeah.
The Creme de la Supreme.
Yeah. Yes, that's how it started, and that's how we started talking.
Mm-hmm. Creme de la Supreme.
That's right, yeah.
Yes. What kind of oil do you use?
Oh, the old oil. I start out by telling her I'm lonesome.
No. No, I mean the salad dressing.
Oh, yes. What about it?
Well, is it good?
Oh, forget it, Bergen.
It isn't fit for a pig.
You might like it, though.
All right.
Oh, she was a nice girl, though.
Yes. Well, where is she now?
I lost her in the crowd at the station in Chicago. Before I could find her, I was on my way to the city hall in the mayor's office.
Yes. That was a grand reception. You know, there's an added thrill in being welcomed back in your old hometown.
Uh-huh.
And being made a guest of the city.
Yeah. You know, old man Dugan was the guest of Chicago once, too.
Yes?
Yeah.
Did he meet the mayor?
No, he didn't. But he had a police escort.
He did.
Yeah. And he had some correspondence with the governor, too.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Governor said no. Yeah.
So he stayed.
Yeah. Poor Dugan. He got his welcome in reverse.
Yes, he did, yes. Oh, well, that's the way it goes. Say, when do we go back to Detroit? I like playing at that state fair.
Well, I'm not taking you any place until I get a rest.
What's the matter?
Well, Charlie, you wear me out.
Is that so?
Yes.
What's the matter, Bergen? Is it your gout?
No, it's not my gout.
Oh.
Charlie, I don't mind telling you, I couldn't make many of these personal appearance tours with you.
You couldn't?
No.
Well, Bergen, I don't mind telling you, you couldn't make many of them without me.
I think we've heard quite enough from you, Charlie.
All right. Take it away, Hollywood.
Now, I'd like to ask you listeners to be selfish for a moment, because this concerns you. It concerns everyone, because it concerns food, perishable foods. Foods that have to be fresh to be good. New-laid eggs, fresh sweet milk, and freshly roasted coffee. Yes, coffee, too, is a perishable food. It is at the best only when it's freshly roasted. For coffee contains delicate oil. In freshly roasted coffee, this oil carries the aroma and flavor that you want in your coffee. But old coffee, stale coffee, loses its goodness. Often becomes rancid tasting and disagreeable to drink. And although coffee, like other perishable foods, can be preserved, millions of people prefer coffee they know is freshly roasted. Chastened Sanborn dated coffee. And here's how you know you always get Chastened Sanborn dated coffee at its best, freshly roasted. The date stamped on the front of every bag tells you when that pound of coffee reached your grocer, fresh from roasting. Rush to him from a nearby roasting oven by our special rapid delivery system. Remember, Chastened Sanborn roasting ovens are located from coast to coast. And your grocer receives his dated coffee every few days from the oven nearest his store. So with Chastened Sanborn dated coffee, you're sure of freshness. Enjoy this superb blend every day. Notice its delightful aroma rising hot from your breakfast cup. Enjoy its refreshing, full flavor iced through the heat of the day. Hot or iced, it gives you finer flavor because it's a blend of the world's choice coffees, freshly roasted. Get a pound from your grocer tomorrow. very lovely Dorothy Lamour sings There's Honey on the Moon Tonight. Dorothy?
There's honey on the moon tonight. It's a sin if we waste it. Come along and let's taste it. Had it ordered for you. There's honey on the moon tonight, though a little off season. It is there for a reason, for a dream to come true. We don't need a boat, a motor car, or a bus. Just any old bench and any old park is made to order for us. There's honey on the moon tonight, and I'm out to enjoy it. What a night to enjoy it with the honey like you. There's honey on the moon tonight. It sure is thin to waste it. Come along, let's taste it. Had it ordered for you. Oh, yes, I know the moon's a little off season, but is that a very good reason? No, no, why a dream can't come true. You know we don't need a boat, a motor car, or a great big bus. Just any old bench and any old car is made to order for us. There's honey on the moon tonight, and I'm out to enjoy it. What a perfect night to enjoy it with a perfect honey like you.
Anyone who saw The Awful Truth or Boy Meets Girl certainly has enjoyed Ralph Bellamy. He was the boy from Oklahoma in The Awful Truth and the motion picture producer in Boy Meets Girl. He plays Ginger Rogers' boyfriend in the latest of Sarah Rogers' picture, Carefree, and he is now at work on the picture Tradewind. It's a pleasure to have such a fine performer with us. Tonight he appears with me in a play by Sir James Barry, a well-remembered voice. Ralph Bellamy in a well-remembered voice.
In France, the war was taking place. At home, this scene might have taken place.
Have you any message you want to send us? Yes. I shall point to the letters of the alphabet, and we shall spell it out in the usual way.
The room is so dark, we cannot see the speaker. All we know is that she is one of two shapes, seated at a small table.
E. Love is the first word. Now the second word.
Beyond the darkness, in a corner of the room, is a man of 50. He is paying no attention to the seance at the table.
Bad. Love, bad.
That's a quotation, isn't it? Is it love, bad, me welcome?
Yes, that's it. Love, bad, me welcome.
The table is moving again.
Yes, and so strangely. Is anyone working against you? Someone antagonistic? I could spell out the name. I should point to the letters of the alphabet. S. A. Is it father? Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I had no intention. I was just sitting here.
Perhaps we'd better call the seance off.
May I go to my room, Mrs. Dunn? I feel I should like to be alone.
Yes, Laura, dear, of course.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night, Laura. I'm sorry. I was in the way, Grace. I wasn't scouting you or anything of the sort. It's just that I can't believe in it.
No, Robert, you would believe if Dick had been to you what he was to me. I guess it's just that a son is so much more to a mother than a father.
I don't know.
Good night, Robert.
Good night, then.
¶¶
Father.
Dick.
I've come to talk with you for a while, Father.
It's you, Dick. It's you.
It's me, all right. Don't be so scared. We don't like that.
My boy, my boy.
Come on. Don't fuss. Let's just try to be our ordinary selves.
I'll try. You didn't say you came to talk with me, Dick. Not with me.
Sure.
But your mother.
We can only come to one, you see.
Only come to one? Goodbye to me.
That's the reason. Hello, here's your old smoking jacket. Greasier than ever.
But, Dick, it's as though you'd forgotten it was your... It was your mother who was everything to you. I used to feel so out of it, but... Of course, you didn't know.
Lots of things I didn't know are clear to me now. I didn't know that you were the one who had missed me most. But I know now.
Me miss you most, Dick? I try to work just as I did before. I go to the club. Dick, I've even been to a dinner party. I said I wouldn't give in.
We like that.
But my boy...
Now then, behave. Smile, Father, smile.
Well, I try to, Dick, I try.
Not your pipe?
I don't seem to care about smoking nowadays.
What? Just because I'm dead? You that try not to give in? I won't have it. Come on. Get your pipe and be quick about it.
Yes, Dick.
And you'd better burn your thumb with a match. That's the way you always did. There. How's that? That's you. Like it?
Well, it's nice, Dick. You and me by the fire.
Yes. But sit still. Sit still. How often we might have been like this, Father? At work?
Yes, how often?
Look, you've still got my fishing rods here.
You love fishing, Dick.
Why didn't you go with me oftener? You know, I'll tell you a funny thing. When I went a soldiering, I used to hope that I wouldn't lose my right arm because it'd be so awkward for casting. Somehow I never thought I should be killed. Lots of fellows thought that about themselves, but I never did. It was quite a surprise to me.
Oh, Dick.
Haven't you gotten over it yet?
No.
I got over it long ago. I wish you people would understand what a little thing it is.
Tell me, Dick, what about the veil? I mean the veil that is drawn between the living and the...
The dead?
Yes.
How funny you shy at that word.
Well, I suppose it's like a mist, huh?
The veil's a queer thing, Father. Yes, it's like a mist. And when one has been at the front for a bit, you can't think how thin the veil seems to get. I suppose it seems thin when you're out there because just one step takes you through it.
Dick.
Come on, smile. Don't let that pipe go out.
Dick, the day that you,
I died?
Yes.
I don't remember being hit. I don't remember anything until the quietness came. It suddenly becomes very quiet. Quieter than anything you've ever known. When I came to, the veil was so thin I couldn't see it at all. My first thought was, which side of it have I come out on?
Let me look at you again, Dick. There's such a serenity about you.
Serenity. That's the word. None of us could remember what the word was. It's a swell thing to have. I wish you could get it, too.
Oh, I'll try.
Say, I've been gabbing here all night. Now, you tell me some things.
What about, Dick? About the war?
No. We have a fine for speaking about the war. I just want to know little things like, has the bathroom tap been mended yet?
Huh? Well, I'm afraid it's just tied up with a string still, Dick. Hey, but it works all right.
It only needs a washer, you know.
Yeah, I'll see to it.
Who's the president of the student body at school?
The president of the student... I'm sorry, Dick, but I don't know.
I suppose not. Is Mother all right?
Yes, but very sad about you, Dick.
Oh, that's not fair. Why doesn't she cheer up?
Oh, it isn't so easy, my boy.
Pretty hard on me, you know.
How's that?
If you're sad, I have to be sad. That's how we have to work it off.
I'll always remember that. And I'll tell your mother. Oh, but she won't believe me, Dick. You'll have to tell her yourself.
Can't do that, Father. I can only come to one.
She should have been the one. She loved you best, Dick.
Oh, I don't know about that. Do you ever see Laura now?
Yes, she's staying with us at present.
Is she? I think I should like to see her.
If Laura were to see you...
Oh, she wouldn't see me. She's not dressed in black, is she?
Oh, no, in white.
Good girl. I suppose Mother's in black.
Of course, Dick.
That's too bad.
Dick, were you engaged to Laura? I never really knew.
No. I sometimes thought of it, but it rather scared me. I guess that's how it was with her, too. Say, here's something new, Father. This table, it never used to be in this room.
No, your mother had it put there.
I used to play backgammon on it. What game does mother play?
I don't know that it's a game, Dick.
Who plays it with her, Laura?
Well, she helps her.
Good for Laura. What are all these letters of the alphabet for?
Do they convey no meaning to you, Dick?
No, why should they?
Oh, no, no reason. No reason at all. Let's go back and sit by the fire.
I never knew much about indoor games anyway.
Robert?
Was that mother calling, Father?
Yes. You will speak to her, Dick. Let her hear your voice.
Only one may hear me.
Robert, never mind now. I wanted you to bring this alphabet up to me, but I'll take it myself.
Grace.
What's the matter? What is it?
Mother. Didn't you hear anything, Grace?
Oh, no. Perhaps Laura was calling.
Yes, perhaps she was. I wish Laura would come back and say goodnight to me.
Maybe she will. I'll ask her.
Father, that was wonderful.
Oh, you should have gone to her, Dick.
Mother's a darling, but she doesn't need me as much as you.
Oh, I don't know.
I'm glad she's so keen about that alphabet game, though.
Mr. Daddy, I came to say goodnight.
Oh, that's nice of you, Laura.
I wanted to come nearer the fire. I can't see her very well there.
Your hands are cold, my dear. Go over by the fire. I want to look at you.
There. Am I all right?
All right. You're beautiful, Laura. Even prettier than I thought. I remember I used to wonder if you really were as pretty as I thought you were. And then you'd come, and you'd be just a little prettier.
Why don't you say anything, Mr. Dunn?
I was just thinking of you and Dick, Laura. If Dick had lived, do you think that you and he...
I think so. Mr. Dunn?
Yes, Laura?
There must be something wicked about me. I sometimes feel quite light-hearted, even though Dick is gone.
Well, perhaps the trees have the same sort of shame when they blossom, but they can't help doing it. I hope you are yet to be a happy woman and a happy wife.
And you're so heartless to Dick.
Not a bit. It's what I like.
It's what he would like, Laura.
Do you remember, Laura? I kissed you once. It was under a lilac tree in Loudon Woods. I knew at the time you were angry, and I should have apologized. I'm sorry, Laura.
What's the matter, Laura?
Somehow, I don't know, but for a moment I seemed to feel the smell of lilac. Dick was once nice to me under a lilac tree. Mr. Dunn.
There now. You'd better go to bed. Good night.
Good night, Mr. Dunn.
Good night, Laura. Pretty awful things, partings, aren't they? Father, don't feel hurt if I skip the goodbyes when I go, will you?
That's so like you, Dick.
I've got to go soon. Oh, smile, Father, smile. You see, if you're bright, I get a good mark for it.
I'll smile.
Remember your pipe?
Yes, Dick.
And your hair's awful.
Yes, I'll have it cut in the morning. Dick, would you rather be here than there?
Not always.
What's the great difference, Dick?
Well, down here, one knows he has risks to run.
Do you miss that?
Must be fun.
And your gaiety, Dick, is it all real or is it just put on to help me?
It's half and half, Father.
And when will you come again?
I can't tell. I can't always get through. They keep changing the password. It's awfully difficult to get the password.
Well, what was it tonight?
Love bade me welcome.
Well, how did you get that, Dick?
I'm not sure. There are lots of things I don't understand yet.
Yes, and there are lots of things I don't understand either. Dick, did you ever try sending messages from there to us?
Me? No.
Or did you ever get messages from us?
No, how could I?
Oh, is there anything in it? Dick, this table, your mother. It was not a game. Dick, where have you gone? Dick!
Smile, Father. Don't forget to smile.
This is Edward Arnold of the Chase and Sanborn Hour goes along with a gay song by Nelson Eddy, the Rattenfinger, the rat catcher, and Nelson tells us what it's all about.
The rat catcher tells you very proudly and boastfully that he's the best catcher of rats and mice and weasels in the whole world. And if one has any truant children, well, he can catch them, too. Then he says that in his spare time, on his own account, he goes after the ladies.
Do Ich bin der wohlbekannte Sänger, der viel gereiste Rattenfänger, in dieser altberühmten Stadt gewiss besonders nötig war. Während Ratten noch so viele und wären wie so mit ihm spielen, von allen Teufel jeder Not, sie müssen miteinander vor. Dann ist der gut gelaunte Sänger mitunter auch ein Kindersänger, der auf die Bilder sein bezwingt. Wenn ihr die goldenen Märchen seht, ist deren Knaben noch so trutzig und deren Mädchen noch so stutzig. In meiner Seite greif ich ein, sie müssen euch und der vielgewandte Sänger gelegentlich ein Mädchenfänger in keinem Städtchenland hier an, wo ihr nicht manche angetan. Wären Mädchen noch so blöd und wären Weiber noch so schröde, doch allen hier so lieber Bang, bei Tauber sei ein Land gesang. Bin der wohlbekannte Sänger, der vielgereiste Rattenfänger, in dieser altberühmte Stadt gewiss besonders nötig hat. Während Ratten noch so viele und wären wieder mit ihm spielen, von allen Teufel dieser Not, sie müssen miteinander vor.
Well, Edward, inasmuch as this is your last day with us, let me express the sentiments of our entire group by telling you that your stay has been extremely delightful.
Well, thank you, Clarence, and I want to tell you boys I've enjoyed every minute I've spent with you. When I leave you, I'll definitely feel that I'm missing something.
Oh, look at me. I didn't take it.
That's the spirit, Claude. All for fun and fun for all, eh?
Edward, such laughter as that is a joy to hear, I can assure you. You have a way of giving yourself up to mirth with such complete abandon, such gusto. I'll wager at times you laugh so heartily that you have to hold your sides. Can you reach them? Well, that's beside the point. Edward's life has been enriched by his ability to laugh. For laughter is truly more precious and more lasting than gold.
Say, that makes me feel like a millionaire with money to burn. That's $10 for you, Claude.
There's a change. Gentlemen, laughter is a gift that wealth can never buy. Suppose, Claude, you were looking for a man who laughed throughout the day, laughed at everything he saw, everything he heard. Where would you seek him? In a palace or in an humble cottage?
In a padded cell.
Well, that's a little extreme. Laughter is a very normal thing and can be very helpful. Suppose you found yourself on the horns of a dilemma, torn between conflicting emotions, pulled first this way, then that way. Would you laugh?
That's split.
Clarence, you remind me of that old song, Let a Smile Be Your Umbrella.
Edward, laughter has inspired many poets. In fact, I have written a little poem about it myself. It's a cinch to be gay when the livelong day brings cheer from dusk till dawn, but best by a mile is a man who can smile
when his two front teeth are gone.
Claude, that is not the last line of my point.
You know, I knew a fellow who had only one tooth missing, and every time he laughed, he whistled Yankee Doodle.
Well, even that might be possible, Edward. There are different kinds of laughter. For instance, Oliver Goldsmith wrote of the loud laugh which bespeaks a vacant mind. If you'll notice, Edward, a person who laughs loudly usually is empty-headed.
Yeah, I've heard people laugh that way. It makes them sound kind of silly, doesn't it? Yes, their minds must suddenly be vacant.
Oh,
Well, Edward.
He hasn't got a brain in his head.
Clark, Edward's laugh is genuine and sincerely robust.
If he's not careful, he'll bust something.
Clark, try to realize this. Edward's laughter is very helpful. Science tells us that laughter brings into play the muscles of the abdomen, the muscles of the throat, the muscles of the face.
And the muscles of the arm.
Well, that's somewhat ridiculous. If you laugh, why do you use the muscles of the arm?
I'm laughing up my sleeve.
You're laughing up your sleeve?
Yes. Ah.
Well, why the short laugh?
I'm wearing short sleeves today.
Oh.
Clark, how can you jest at a time like this?
Yeah, Clark, this is no laughing matter.
Well, thank you, Edward. I am proud to say that for generations, the Strouds have passed down the rich heritage of laughter. Our ancestors have always laughed, even in the face of adversity. In the Battle of Waterloo, a Stroud died laughing. In the Battle of Bunker Hill, a Stroud died laughing. When I was brought into this world...
The doctor died laughing.
Claude, how can you make such a statement?
I was there, wasn't I?
Well, regardless of that, I...
Say, Clarence, before this gets too involved, I think now Bellamy might be interested in what you're saying. I don't know why, but he might.
Well, splendid, Edward.
Ralph, these are the Stroud twins. They resemble each other like two peas in a pod. I know you'll be delighted to meet them.
I reckon they're all right if you like peas in a pod.
I reckon he's all right if you like corn on the cob.
Claude, you should be elated at Mr. Bellamy's presence. He is a cinema star of the first magnitude, a poised, self-possessed man of the world, a man of great polish.
Oh, shucks, fellas. I
think the polish is wearing off.
Ain't he a card?
Ralph, you have a very interesting laugh. I would classify that as a deep, resonant, abdominal laugh. Notice, Claude, that Ralph's laugh came straight from the stomach.
Yeah, right from the Bellamy.
Oh, say, that reminds me. I heard a good one last night. Claude, I asked you why my girl calls me Mustard Plaster, then you asked me why, and I say, because I always stick around. Get it, Claude? Mustard Plaster?
Stick?
God, I expected a better laugh.
I studied a better joke.
Well, Ralph, it looks like you got the horse laugh.
Edward, horses do not laugh. They are not capable of producing the sound ha, which is the basis of laughter. There is the single or aloof version, ha. The double or friendly version, ha ha. The triple or intensified version, ha ha ha. The quadruple.
Or the Sunday driver's version, ha 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 ha.
Well, I know one, Clarence. It's the Southern or Gone with the Wind version.
It seems to me that you are interposing needless jocularity into what I meant for a serious discussion. We mustn't forget...
We mustn't forget the theme song laugh.
Why, Mr. Armbruster, the theme song laugh.
Sure.
What about the turkey's or here she is boys version?
Your conception of the various kinds of laughter is a little far-fetched.
Say, you've forgotten the most important laugh of all, the sad laugh of the clown Pagliacci. Laugh, clown, laugh!
Gee, that was sad, Nelson.
It certainly was.
Please, this has gone far enough.
Oh, no, no. We left out the villain's laugh for I'll foreclose the mortgage laugh.
Please start, Kitty.
What you are doing is not legitimate laughter. Real laughter is an integration causing a conversion of potential into kinetic energy in the brain cells and the discharge of activating secretions in the bloodstream for the purpose of producing muscular action. Laugh that one off.
Oh, that's marvelous, Clarence. What'd you say?
I said laughter is an integration causing...
Integration, eh? Oh, that's good.
Yes, an integration causing a conversion...
Conversion? That's wonderful.
Causing a conversion of potential into kinetic energy in the brain...
Oh, Connecticut energy,
Yes, the kinetic energy into the brain cells and the discharge of activating secretions into the bloodstream. In the bloodstream, the purpose of producing... Do you understand? That's what makes us laugh.
Laughter is not the only thing that's good for the soul. A good song helps, too. And here it is. Dorothy Lamour sings, "I Let a Song Go Out of My Heart."
I let a song go out of my heart. It was the sweetest melody. I know I lost heaven, 'cause you were the song. Since you and I have drifted apart, life doesn't mean a thing to me. Please come back, sweet music. I know I was wrong. Am I too late to make amends? You know that we were meant to be more than just friends. Just friends. I let a song go out of my heart. Believe me, darling, when I say I won't know sweet music until you return someday. I know I lost heaven, 'cause you were the song. Now it's a sad song. Life doesn't mean a thing to me. Please come back, sweet music. I know I was wrong. Hope I'm not too late to make amends. You know that we were meant to be lots more than just good friends. I let a song go out of my heart. Believe me, darling, when I say I won't know sweet music until you return someday. Don't stay away. I won't be glad till you return someday.
Today is Red Letter Day in the life of our perambulating pal, Charlie McCarthy. Edgar Bergen's alma mater, Northwestern University, is awarding an honorary degree to Charlie. And he is in Chicago, all spruced up and raring to go to accept. Charlie, all of us congratulate you. I'll bet you look awfully cute in that hat and gown.
Yeah, if only Dottie could see me now. I look so academical, but I feel like a fool.
I think you look very good in that outfit, Charlie.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
I feel awfully silly in this kimono.
It's a gown.
Oh, all right, so it's a gown. But I still think it would look better with a belt in the back.
Yeah, I see. No, Charlie.
No.
No,
no. Oh, uh-huh. Maybe I should have worn a slip under it. It's awful drafty. It really is. It's drafty. That's what it is.
Haven't you got your suit under it?
My suit, Oh! I knew I forgot something.
Charlie, don't tell me that you go... Bergen, this isn't the place. I just...
why do they call these four-cornered hats
motorboats? No. It's a cap.
Oh.
And it's called mortarboard.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's all right, I guess. I look better in an off-the-face hat. But it fits good. You see, it's good. I'll say that for it.
Yes.
Well, you see, it's held on by vacuum.
Yeah.
Well, I got what it takes.
Yes, you certainly have.
Yes. I still say this kimono ain't made right. I don't know. It just ain't chicky, that's all. Just ain't chic. I don't know.
Charlie, you have the wrong attitude about your cap and gown.
Do I?
Yes, you have.
Oh.
And remember, I expect you to be dignified and serious when the degree is conferred upon you.
Oh, sure.
And another thing.
Oh, enough of this small talk. How about slipping me the wool hide? All right.
Sheepskin.
Yeah, sheepskin. Yeah, that's what it is. When do I get it?
All right.
Do I get it or do I get it?
Oh, don't be impatient. Dean Dennis will be here very soon.
Yeah. Well, you know, Bergen, well, don't look now. Don't look now. What's the matter? Here comes a guy with a mate to my gown. You know, that's Dean Dennis. That's Dean Dennis.
How do you do, Mr. Dennis?
Hello, Edgar.
Charlie, this is Mr. Ralph Dennis, Dean of the School of Speech, Northwestern University.
See, he's got a long name, hasn't he? He's important, huh?
Oh, yes.
Don't let it frighten you, Charlie. My friends call me Si.
Oh, well, that's better. Hi, Si.
No. Not so fast, Charlie.
Oh, all right. Hi, Dean.
Charlie McCarthy.
Yes, Your Honor. No, I mean... pardon me, continue.
I'm about to confer on you your honorary degree because you were for many years a student at Northwestern University, though largely in absentia, since you were helping Edgar earn the money for his education. Further, you are possessed of a capacity for research surpassed only by your ability to speak for yourself. You are known for your wit and wisdom, not to mention your willingness to borrow all your ideas from the person nearest you. You are a prince of parasites, violent in company, churlish in behavior, acid in conversation, wooden taste in all relationships, and thus in all respects a typical product of higher education in America. You are famed for your investigation into the value of timber in voice production and are nationally known as a contributor to a field of entertainment which deserves the fate you have brought upon it. Therefore, I present you with this sheepskin and this honorary degree, Master of Innuendo and Snappy Comeback. My congratulations, Charlie.
And my congratulations, too, Charlie.
Gee.
Is that all you can say?
Gee whiz. This is embarrassing.
What's the matter, Charlie?
Well, I've just been made master of innuendo and snatty comebacks, and Bergen can't think of a thing to say.
Personally, Charlie, I think you've well earned this degree.
Thank you, Dean Dennis. But it's all a little confusing.
It is? Why?
Well, once you call me a prince of parachutes...
No.
Parasite. Parasite. Say, what is a parasite?
A parasite, Charlie, is a person who lives off the efforts of others.
Oh, lives off the efforts of others. Yeah. Say, who's getting this degree, me or Bergen?
You are, Charlie, and you deserve it. Now, is there anything else you want to explain?
Yes, there is. First you say I was a student at Northwestern, and then you turn around and say I was a student in absentia. Now, where was I?
That's right, Charlie. You were a student in absentia at Northwestern.
In absentia at Northwestern, yes. Well, you wormed out of that, all right. But it clears up nothing.
That means that you were absent most of the time.
Oh, absent, yeah. Oh, I majored in that.
We understood that, Charlie, and took into consideration that your time away from school was spent in helping Edgar get through college.
Yes. How I sacrificed for that boy.
And what has he done for me?
Look at him.
I can't.
It is true, we did work together so that I might get a degree.
Yeah.
And I'm proud to say that I got it in only 3.5 years.
Yes, you did. But it was only a 2-year course. Oh.
Was that necessary?
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Unfortunately, in my student days, I wasn't in the best of health.
Oh, Bergen, as a student, you were very puny.
Oh, no, Charlie. Edgar was a very conscientious student.
Thank you, Mr. Dennis. As grateful as I am for my college education, I hope that it never went to my head.
No, it sure didn't.
No, all right, boy.
It never even got near it. Oh.
How well I remember my classes with you, Mr. Dennis.
Yes, you were sort of quiet and retiring, Edgar. You never had much to say in class.
Well, I can explain that.
Yes, yeah, so can I. Mm. You can't sleep and talk at the same time.
You know, this meeting with you, Mr. Dennis, revives so many pleasant memories.
Yes, it does. It certainly does.
Yeah. Say, wait a minute here. I've been reading this goatskin.
Sheepskin.
The sheepskin?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
And yeah, whatever it is. And it says here that I am a prince of parasites and violet and company. Now, that's an insult in sheep's clothing. That's what it is.
Charlie, you don't understand what it means.
No, I guess not.
Yes.
Well, I know what it means. It means I've come 2,000 miles to be insulted. That's what it means.
Oh, no, Charlie. Master of innuendo and snappy comebacks is most unusual. In fact, you're the only person in the world who ever received such a degree, and I assure you it's a great honor.
Well, now that's a horse of a different sheepskin, or whatever I mean. Mr. Dennis, I want you to know that if there's in any way which I can be of any assistance or show my appreciation, don't hesitate to call on me.
Charlie, you're very gracious. I can tell you one thing we want. We want to enlarge our library.
Say no more about it. I shall send you a book in the morning.
That's not enough. What we want is a new wing.
A wing? That's where I fly out. Hollywood, here I come.
Listeners will want to make a special note of this because it's to your advantage.
Certain important foods are highly perishable. You want them just as fresh as you can get them. Fresh eggs, fresh milk, and freshly roasted coffee. Yes, coffee is just like other perishable foods. To get it at its best, it must be fresh. For there's a delicate oil in coffee. When the coffee is freshly roasted, that oil carries a tempting aroma and delicious flavor every coffee lover demands. But in stale coffee, changes take place. Stale coffee can become rancid tasting and disagreeable. And although coffee can be preserved, millions of people prefer coffee that is freshly roasted. Chasen Sanborn dated coffee. That is why the Chasen Sanborn roasting ovens are located all over the United States. Your grocer is supplied with freshly roasted coffee from the oven nearest to his store. And every bag of Chasen Sanborn coffee is dated, stamped plainly with a delivery date so you can know it is freshly roasted. Get a pound of Chasen Sanborn dated coffee tomorrow. Enjoy the richer flavor of this freshly roasted coffee and notice the depth of color, the fresh, tempting fragrance, the rich, full body of this superb blend. Drink it hot in the morning, serve it iced as the day gets warmer. Chasen Sanborn dated coffee is ideal for making iced coffee because of that rich, freshly roasted flavor. And hot or iced, you're sure of finer coffee because Chasen Sanborn dated coffee is a superb blend, freshly roasted. Buy a pound tomorrow.
The very familiar and well-loved composition by the American composer Ethelbert Nevin. Nelson Eddy sings The Rosary.
The hours I spent with thee, dear heart, are as a string of pearls to me. I confess and burn. Oh, barren gain and bitter loss. I kiss each speed and strive at last to learn to kiss the cross.
End of another Chase and San Bernard, and the end of a very enjoyable few weeks of acting as your host. For next Sunday, Don Amici returns to his old job, back from a vacation in Europe. I certainly will be listening in, and I trust you will too. The best way to tell us that you enjoy our programs is by your purchases of Chase and Sanborn coffee. Besides the return of Don Amici, there's another special treat for next Sunday. For the guest will be the lovely Warner Brothers star, Olivia de Havilland. Edgar Bergen will be back from Chicago with Charlie. And we'll also hear from Nelson, Eddy, Dorothy, Lamour, the Stroud twins, and Robert Armbruster, and the Chase and Sanborn Orchestra. This is Edward Arnold saying goodbye.
Be with us again next Sunday for another big Chase and Sanborn Hour. Heard on this program was The Big Show by Jerome Kern. We are grateful to B.T. Schoberg for the appearance of Edward Arnold and to Harry Cohn and Columbia Pictures for the appearance of Ralph Bellamy. This is Wendell Niles speaking for the makers of Chase and Sanborn Coffee. This is the National Broadcasting Company.